right. Well, good evening and Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Good to see you all here tonight as we celebrate our final sounds of Christmas, and a very special one at that. As you can see, we have some special lights, and they're good reminders of us that we are the light of the world. Yeah. And, you know, it kind of reminds me of this hill just up the street here. You know, we're the city on a hill. You can finish the verse, but we'll think about what we're going to do here as we sing. As our first song as a congregation tonight, number 315 in the blue hymnals. Ask you to grab the blue hymnals, turn to 315, and please stand as we sing both of those verses. Let's sing about ringing the bells, letting the world know that Christ is born. Ring the bells, ring the bells, let the whole world know Christ was born in Bethlehem many years ago. Born to die that man might live, came to earth new life to give. Born of Mary, born so low, many years ago. God the Father gave his Son, gave his own beloved one, to this wicked, sinful earth, to bring mankind new love, new birth. Ring the bells, ring the bells, let the whole world know. Christ the Savior lives today, as he did so long ago. Ring the bells, ring the bells, what a glorious morn. Men and angels worship him, singing Christ is born. Born to die on Calvary, born to set his people free. God himself in human form, tell it Christ is born. He has left his royal throne, he is to claim his own. Christ the Lord has come to earth, go spread the news of Jesus' birth. Ring the bells, ring the bells, let the whole world know. Christ the Savior lives today, as he did so long ago. Thank you. Please be seated.
Appropriate verse connected to that song. Welcome to First Baptist Church of Westminster for our Christmas Eve candlelight service and sounds of Christmas. Luke chapter 2, verse 29 to 32 reads, Lord, now lettest thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of thy people Israel. Again, welcome to First Baptist Church of Westminster tonight. We're so glad that you're here. Church family, friends, family, thank you for coming. And for those watching on Zoom, thank you for connecting with us as well. We trust that your day has been blessed and looking forward to what we all celebrate tomorrow and what we celebrate every Sunday in the resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ. He came to give himself for us. And so we're glad that you're here tonight. We hope that you'll make yourself at home. And I'd like to ask Alex to come and open our service tonight with a word of prayer.
Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for sending your Son down to save us from our sins. Lord, thank you for allowing us to meet here tonight and to praise you. Lord, please allow us to be a blessing and to see the light and maybe get a burden to be a brighter light for you. Lord, we praise and thank you for allowing us to meet together. Please be with those who weren't able to come and for those visiting family and traveling. Lord, please give them travel mercies. Lord, we'll praise you and thank you for all that's said and done. Please allow us to be a blessing to you and to our community, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Luke chapter number 1, Luke chapter number 1, I'll read verse 50 as we consider God's word tonight. Luke chapter 1, how great our joy. In verse number 50, we read part of Mary's song of praise. And in verse number 50 of Luke 1, the Bible says, "And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation." Alexander McLaren, that expositor of days gone by, said this, "Birds sing at dawn and sunrise. It was fitting that the last strains of the Old Testament psalmody should prelude the birth of Jesus. Doxology is a hymn of praise unto the Lord." As we think about these verses in Luke chapter 1, I draw your attention to verse number 45, where we read this morning, if you were with us, "And blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told her from the Lord." Now listen to what Mary says here in verse number 46. "And Mary said, My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior." Can you magnify the Lord tonight with Mary in your soul and in your spirit? A doxology is a hymn of praise to the Lord. It reminds us, as we think about the birth of Christ, the birth of Jesus, it's far more than gifts, truths, myths like Santa Claus, Rudolph, Frosty. I don't know which one was your favorite. My personal favorite was the Grinch growing up. Always got to watch that with my mom for Christmas traditions. You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. But, you know, these are myths. These are fictitious things. But there's something even more special about Christmas in the fact that Jesus Christ, this season, is about our relationship with our Lord, about learning to celebrate His glory, to celebrate His goodness. Hey, listen close tonight. I'm so glad that you're here to think about the Word of God with me, because God is the Savior of anyone who will humbly trust Him and realize that there is no help without His divine intervention. Look at Mary's words again. Mary said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord. My spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior." Why, Mary? Why do you magnify the Lord so in your spirit? Verse 48. "For he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden." Remember what she said earlier? If you read back just a few verses in her conversation with Gabriel, "Behold, the handmaid of the Lord." She's saying here that God has regarded her in her low estate, the low estate of his handmaiden, for "Behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed." Hey, look at that word blessed. We saw that in verse 45. "Blessed is she that believed." Mary here ascribes this blessedness. "All generations shall call me blessed." The Magnificat, that's the Latin term for it, where we get that idea. The song is called, consists almost entirely of Old Testament allusions and quotations. Can I just say that even as a 12-year-old, 13-year-old, 14-year-old young girl, and I know that's crazy for us to think about today, but these are Bible times, and I understand a 12, 13, 14-year-old would probably be a lot more mature in this day and time than our 12, 13, 14-year-old would be today. But this is a young girl who, she doesn't have Genesis to Revelation written down for her like you and I do. She would have to go out of her way to even access a scroll of the Old Testament, wouldn't she? The scrolls were kept in the synagogue. How did she know so much of the Word of God? It was in her. And this song of praise, when she magnifies the Lord with her soul, hey, you get out what you put in. This is a young lady who has put the Word of God into her life, and now it exudes forth when she opens her mouth in praise. And you see these allusions, these quotations, not only in her song, but in the songs of Zechariah and Simeon later, that Luke gives us these songs of Christmas. there are some resemblances to other songs in the Old Testament as well. You think about the song of Hannah in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. But this is a little bit of a difference in tone. Hannah's song, on one hand, that's a shout of triumph in the face of her enemies. Mary's song is a humble contemplation of the mercies of God. Mercy. The mercies of God. Other hymns of praise that were sung in response to God's gracious and powerful intervention on behalf of His people. You have songs in Sunday school this morning. We were talking about the Song of Moses and the children of Israel when God parted the Red Sea for them. That's a song in the Bible. You have the Song of Miriam that follows Moses' song. You have the Song of Deborah in Judges chapter 5. You have the Song of Asaph in 1 Chronicles chapter 16. You have the Song of Judith, which is extra biblical, but is a poetry, nonetheless. You have the Song of Hannah that I mentioned. Songs are meant to help us hold on to truths in lyric fashion, but in a way that sticks with us. Wonder, praise, humility, exaltation, adoration, congratulation. These colors chase one another in the heart of this jewels, F.B. Meyer put it once. Notice in verse 46 to 50, Mary has praise to my personal Savior. Now, she's saying my personal Savior, but this is to my personal Savior. I cannot read her song without seeing such a personal connection that she has with the Lord. Hey, when we get personal with God, God does some special things. Look at verse 46. Mary said, my soul. Whose soul? My soul. How about your soul tonight? Can you say, my soul doth magnify? How did she magnify the Lord? We see the praise of her mouth. It says, and Mary said, hey, it's a good thing that we can just take the Bible for what it says. Amen. Because the scholars and the seminaries and things and those that would take a liberal viewpoint question whether Mary actually said these things. But Mary said them. So either we have to rely on the scholars to figure out what Mary said or didn't say, or we just take Luke's word for it, that he did his homework, that he did his research, as he said in chapter 1. And I have no problem pillowing my head tonight knowing that these are words that Mary said. Mary said these words, my soul. She gave the Lord the praise of her mouth. Mary's whole being is involved in her praise. Body, soul, and spirit. You see it in this passage so beautifully, physically, mentally, emotionally. She's engaging in adoration of her Savior. She adores Him with everything in her. She praises Him with her mouth. She praises Him from her soul. She says, my soul doth magnify the Lord. To magnify the Lord means to make great, to extol, to praise, to celebrate. It doesn't mean here strictly to make great, but to increase in our estimation, that is, to praise, to extol, to magnify. Oh, I have so many scriptures that I could point you to, and we could trace a theme of magnifying the Lord through the Bible. Acts chapter 5, verse 13, Acts chapter 10, verse 46, Acts chapter 19, verse 17, Philippians chapter 1, verse 20. To enlarge, we see it translated as enlarge in Matthew 23, 5. To show great, Luke 1, 58. Just turn ahead maybe a page or look across the page and look at Luke 1, 58. To be enlarged, 2 Corinthians 10, 15. My soul doth magnify the Lord. It makes the Lord large. It shows Him great. It extols Him. Jehovah had promised something to Abraham to make his name great. You go read Genesis 12, 1 through 3. That was something the Lord promised He would do for Abraham. And here's Mary saying, I'm going to make the Lord great. I'm going to magnify the Lord, to praise Him. So now Mary makes the name of the Lord great. Psalm 33, 4, Psalm 34, verses 1 through 3. I mean, just scripture after scripture. Can we not make the Lord great tonight? Let's make the Lord great. She praises the Lord with her mouth. She praises the Lord with her soul. Her soul magnifies the Lord. Mary said she praises the Lord in her spirit. She's rejoicing in God her Savior. Did you catch her words in verse 47? My spirit, whose spirit? Mary's spirit. My spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior, hath rejoiced. Look at the way that this is said. When she says, my soul doth magnify. When she says, my spirit hath rejoiced. This is just something that Mary does. Doth is a word we don't really use much today, but it gives you a window into what you're seeing in the language. It's something that Mary has done and is doing and is going to continue doing as long as Mary has breath. She's going to say, my soul doth praise the Lord, doth magnify the Lord. She praises Him in her spirit. She rejoices in her Savior. Look at her words. Redeemed by God, my Savior. Now that's important too. I hope you realize you're in a Baptist church tonight. I want to be kind, but Romanists may declare that Mary was born without inbred sin. They hold to a doctrine that's called Immaculate Conception, which we would disagree with according to what the Scripture says herself. Here, Mary says, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God, my who? Savior. Why would Mary need a Savior if she was without sin? These last three words, God, my Savior. Mary then, lovely as she was, I'm sure, beautiful in her character, perhaps beyond any other young woman of her day, yet she realized that in herself she was a sinner. As Paul said, Pharisee of the Pharisees, I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. Here Mary says, I need a Savior. She realized that in herself she was a sinner who needed a Savior, and she found that Savior to be none other than God Himself. Hey, when we get personal with God, God gets personal with us. Look at verse 48. For He hath regarded the low estate of His handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth shall all generations shall call me blessed, regarded by God. I thought of Hagar as she was escaping from that situation, that horrible situation with Abraham and Sarah in Genesis 16. She said these words, Thou God seest me. You understand, God looks down upon us and sees us in our poor estate. He regards our poor estate, as Mary calls it here. El Roy, Thou God seest me, Genesis 16, 13. Not only is Mary saying she's regarded by God, but she's rewarded by God. He has called me blessed. Do you see her reward? For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. She was not going to be the one who would confer blessings, but she was going to be the one that would receive the blessings. God would bless her and did bless her. So as an Old Testament believer, Mary's hope of salvation rested in the same thing that your salvation and my salvation must rest in tonight. God, His Word, and His promises. Her hope was not in her own ability to make herself acceptable to God. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26 through 28 says, For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world, and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. As we continue thinking about the music that we're being blessed with tonight, who is this King of Glory?
Bethlehem.
Luke chapter 1 and verse 49, continuing Mary's praise. For he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name. Who is this King of glory? Mary knew some things about God, her Savior. He is omnipotent. She claims this when she says, mighty hath done great things. There is nothing too hard for God. She has just witnessed the impossible being done in Elizabeth being able to conceive and bring forth John the Baptist with Zechariah. God is the God of the impossible. With men, these things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. She says, "Holy is His name. He is holy. He is everlastingly merciful." If you look at verse number 50, she says, "His mercy," there's that idea of mercy again, "His mercy is on them that fear Him from generation to generation." The everlasting mercy of the Lord is central to Mary's praise. God is a faithful God. He keeps covenant. He keeps mercy with them that love Him and keep His commandments. Deuteronomy 7:9 says, to 1,000 generations. The fullness of the Holy Spirit that we see in Elizabeth and with Mary, the power of the Holy Spirit in their praise should lead to joyful praise in our lives. Warren Wiersbe said this, the fullness of the Spirit should lead to joyful praise in our lives. And he quotes Ephesians 5 verses 18 to 20. And so should the fullness of the Word, Colossians 3, 16 and 17. Mary, her Lord, was very personal to her as her Savior. Now consider the praise that she gives to our merciful God. Watch the pronoun usage that Mary has. It's very intriguing. You see, the practice of God's mercy in a fallen, sinful world. Verse 51 to 53 show us this. God has mercy to help the helpless. He takes up their cause. Verse 51, we read in Mary's song again, He hath showed strength with His arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. The arm of the Lord. Remember Isaiah 53, that beautiful passage that shows us the suffering servant of the Lord that comes to redeem us. To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed, His strength to save? There's a story that's given by J.C. Ryle. A remark of Whitby on this expression is worth notice. He said, God's great power is represented by His finger, greater by His hand, greatest by His arm. The production of lice, talking about the plagues on Egypt in Exodus 8:19, was by the finger of God. The other miracles in Egypt were wrought by His hand. Exodus 3:20 shows the destruction later on in Exodus 15:6. The destruction of Pharaoh and his host in the Red Sea was by His arm. The finger, the hand, and the arm. Our God is mighty to save. God scatters the proud who are self-sufficient. One writer put it like this, the proud look down on others because they do not look up to God. And so in the Bible, the proud are constantly presented as God's enemies. Isaiah 13:11. Think about that. Do we want to be lifted up with pride? Pride goeth before contention and an haughty spirit before a fall. Or would we rather not come like Mary and humble ourselves before the mighty arm of God? You see, that's to whom God extends mercy. He gives grace to the humble. Verse 52, Mary records this in her song. She says, He hath put down the mighty from their seats. Seats could also be translated thrones. And exalted them of low degree. For the Lord's mercy, I remind you of a beautiful verse in Lamentations chapter 3. You know this verse. Lamentations 3, verse 22 to 23. It's only of the Lord's mercies that we're not consumed. Do you remember that? Because His compassions fail not. We get a great hymn from the truth of these verses, do we not? Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, we see the Lord's mercy. You see, Mary's giving us some things here about the mercy of the Lord. In Isaiah 57:15, put that verse up if you would. Isaiah 57 verse 15 tells us exactly with whom the Lord dwells.
He dwells with those who are of a contrite spirit. For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place. Whose writing? Isaiah is. The one who said earlier in the book, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. He says, the Lord dwells in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit. And why does the Lord dwell with them? To revive the spirit of the humble, not the proud. To revive the heart of the contrite ones. Mary, speaking from experience in her humility. To be mighty in this sense, and what Mary gives us, is to be self-sufficient and in no need of salvation. God doesn't need a Savior. He is the Savior. He is self-sufficient in and of Himself. Humility, Andrew Murray gave a near-perfect definition. Humility is perfect quietness of heart. That's how he put it. It is to expect nothing, to wonder at nothing that is done to me, to feel nothing done against me. It is to be at rest when nobody praises me and when I'm blamed or despised. It is to have a blessed home in the Lord where I can go in and shut the door and kneel to my Father in secret and am at peace as in a deep sea of calmness when all around and above is trouble. Listen now, the humble person is not one who thinks meanly of himself or basely, if you will. He simply is, according to Andrew Murray, does not think of himself at all. God's mercy is to the humble. God's mercy is to the hungry. Look at verse 53 in Mary's song. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich hath he sent away. He hath sent away empty. The riches of his mercy, the riches of his grace, the riches of his love, the riches of his glory, the riches of Christ that we have availed to us. All of these are for those that come to Him acknowledging the poverty that they have in their own need. Jesus Himself said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We can receive His bounty at His good hand. We continue our songs and we think about the riches of His mercy. And in light of the world in which we live, as we prepare for this next song, Joy to the World, you know, we do have joy that we can sing about tonight. And it's not like the world defines it. Karl Marx considered religion the opiate of the people. That's what he called it. But it's clear that he had not paid proper attention to Mary's speech, which is not just personal, but it deals with theology. It deals with social ethics. It deals with politics. It deals with economics. Think about the world that Jesus Christ is coming to make new. He's going to give us a new heaven and a new earth. And so I'm going to ask those that are getting ready for this next song to come while I read this poem from Sunshine Magazine, The Most with the Least. I saw him sitting in his door, trembling as old men do. His house was old, his barn was old, and yet his eyes seemed new. His eyes had seen three times my years and kept a twinkle still, though they had looked at birth and death and three graves up a hill. I will sit with you, I said, and you'll make me wise. Tell me how you've kept the joy still burning in your eyes. Then, like an old-time orator, impressively he arose. I make the most of all that comes and the least of all that goes. The jingling rhythm of his words echoed as old songs do, yet this had kept his eyes alight till he was 92. Joy to the world.
Christmas morn, to the place where Christ was born. Kneel we reverently before his feet, wise men, shepherds, here we meet. Hear the angels singing of his birth, his good will to men upon the earth. Go we joyously the world to tell, ring we merrily the Christmas bell. This is he whom the bards foretold, bring him incense, myrrh, and gold. This the babe whom to sing, crown him prophet, priest, and king. He will live a sinless life, he will die a sacrifice. He will rise and remove death's sting. Hear the Christmas bell we ring. Ring the bell for the world to hear. Death and hell should hold no fear. This sweet babe in a manger bed hath the power to raise the dead. He hath keys to hell's domain. In his hands the serpent's chain. At his feet every knee shall bow, as the ox and the ass do now. Every bell in the world should ring, giving honor to our King. Bells of silver, bronze, and gold, bells of iron that ring out bold. Let them all with one accord be loud welcome to our Lord. Tell to sinners far and near, Jesus Christ, God's Son, is here.
Thinking again about God's mercy, Mary went on in verse 54 to 56 to show God's mercy to Israel as well as to the rest of the world through Israel. God's mercy. What does God's mercy mean? God's mercy means help. That's what it means. Look at verse 54 of her song. He hath holpen his servant Israel. Now, holpen's not a word we use a lot today either, like the word doth. But it simply means to help. And what a beautiful way that this is phrased. In remembrance of his mercy, she goes on. In remembrance, that's an infinitive. So this would be some language usage, Hebraisms. Literally, we would say this is a remembering. In remembrance, he has helped his slave Israel. This is my rough personal translation, okay? So don't get too excited about this, because the authorized version is much more beautiful, but just a literal wooden translation. He has helped his slave Israel, remembering his mercy as he spake to our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed into the ages. You know what God's mercy means? God's mercy means his help. He has holpen. He helps. God's mercy is according to his past promises. This is what Mary knew. Verse 55, the first part of that says, as he spake to our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed forever. That word seed is theologically rich. And it's fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Go read Galatians and you'll find out what I mean. Everything that we need is found in Jesus Christ. Mary had verified the prophecy of Gabriel that was given to her to be true through the prophesying of Elizabeth being filled with the Holy Spirit here in this passage, trusted God wholeheartedly to bring to pass the precious promises of the ages gone by, unfolding right before her very eyes. Through her, through Mary, would come the capital S, seed of Abraham, to bless all the families of the earth with redemption. May I remind you tonight that the Lord still keeps his promises. He will never allow anything he has promised to go undone. Romans chapter 4, 21 reminds us of that. This is why he can be trusted fully and completely in every situation in our life, whether it be for salvation, as we read in 2 Timothy 1:12, or for daily provision that we know from Philippians 4:19. God will do what he said he will do. And so, let's learn to trust him. Learn to trust him. Learn to praise him as Mary did. Praise him for his goodness, even if the answer is not yet seen. We believe by faith. If there's one thing that we can be sure of in this Christmas Eve service tonight, it is that we can and should and must depend upon the Lord. He will never let a single one of his promises fall to the ground. God's mercy is help. God's mercy is according to his past promises. God's mercy, and this is a really good part of it, is forever. It is forever. Look at verse 55 again. Just being led to praise the Lord with Mary as he spake to our fathers and to Abraham and to his seed. How long? Forever. Mary finds her way to faith because she reads the signs of the past aright. That's how Coleridge put it in his comments on this. She finds her way to faith because she reads the signs of the past aright. Black as things might look sometimes around us, as Brother Mike mentioned when we started here tonight, there's a great light that we look for in hope, that we are on the brink. It has to be so close to the Lord's appearing. And that light will come to appear to bring full deliverance. As we think about concluding our service with some candlelight tonight, let's think about what this light represents. We are the light of the world through Jesus. He's the light of the world, but he told his disciples that ye are the light. A city that is set upon a hill cannot be hid. So we don't take these candles tonight and put them under a bushel. No. We hold forth the light of Christ. Now, these are just candles. If we walk around town holding these out, is that going to help anybody get saved? Hey, look, I found a candle. Great, that's a nice candle. Can you tell them about the Lord? Can the light of your life that burns from the light of Christ be reflected from Jesus Christ into the lives of others as you go out to celebrate his birth tomorrow, this week, and really with Mary every day, praising our Savior for who he is? Let's learn from this holy woman's example to lay firm hold on the Bible's promises, because promises are, in fact, a little bit of metaphoric manna that we should daily eat, the water that we should daily drink. We travel through the wilderness of this world. We see not yet all things put under us. We see not Christ in heaven and the book of life, the mansions that are prepared for us. We walk by faith. And this faith learns to lean on God's promises. But on those promises, we can lean confidently. God will never let one fall to the ground. They will bear all the weight that we can lay on them. And we'll find one day, like the Virgin Mary, that God keeps his word. That what he has spoken, so he will always, in due time, bring a performance of those things, to quote Elizabeth in her song. So at this time, we invite you to participate with us as we light candles in remembrance of our Savior's birth, the light of the world that he's given to us as his disciples to take and each one reach one. And so I'll begin down here in the middle, and hopefully you got a candle when you came in, and we'll just light each other's candle and pass this light along as a little bit of a living sermon to remind us what we ought to be doing as Christians. join me in song if you would.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep.
Voices only on this last verse.
Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth.
And take this spirit of prayer and worship with you as you go out to celebrate the birth of our Savior. This concludes our service tonight. God bless you. Merry Christmas.